Professor Hudetsak is going to speak about overcoming history, with a question mark, I assume.
Okay.
Slavko.
Thank you so much, Tim. Thank you for a kind introduction. I presume you do realize that being Ukrainian historian is a kind of challenge, because before Ukrainian independence, if you do Ukrainian history, in the eyes of many, you see the history of country or nation which doesn't exist. So by definition, would be nationalistic. And now when you come in deep in the Ukrainian crisis, have a Ukrainian historian here, there is always a danger that you will find here a spin doctor talking to provide legitimacy of new Ukrainian power. I have to confess my certain subjectivity. I was on Maidan. I was working with the people there. Actually, some of the friends and colleagues who've been there, most of my friends and colleagues have been there. Those people who are now on the front line, so to say, they are those also my people. One of my students has died under Maidan, under this kind of terrible shootings. Actually, I'm very much involved. So in order not to overexceed with my subjectivity, I would like to start with something which probably not that raised that many discussion. And this is the simple issue. We may discuss and disagree on many issues, but one thing goes for sure, all of us are mortal. So all of us are bound to die sooner or later, for sure better later than sooner. So the main tendency of the last 200 years, and here I'm playing into the hands of Holly, so to say, the main tendency of the last 200 years, we have a very impressive increase of life expectancy, first of all in Europe, but then all around the world. So what I'm going to show you in this map, this scheme, is the dynamic of life expectancy in Ukraine and Europe throughout all 20th century, starting in 900, ending actually with 206. It's more than 100 century. This is the statistic, this is about males. We know the females tend to live longer, but basically these dynamics are more or less the same. So the green color is for Ukraine. The orange color is for Western Europe as defined as the European Union before 204, before the further integration. So what is interesting here, we see this kind of general tendency of increase of the life expectancy. It's a general, be it Europe or Ukraine, this doesn't really make that much difference. What is really different there? First of all, this is definite gap. Ukrainians tend to live shorter, sometimes much shorter. There's only one exception around 60s, which is in kind of time was a blessing time, both either in Eastern Europe or in the Soviet Union, probably the best time, the happiest decade in the 20th century, when you have the kind of level more or less the same. But basically, it's a 10, sometimes even 30 years difference, which is a lot. But I would like to draw your attention to these two specific low points here. The first one is 1942-43, with a life expectancy among the males 17.7 years, compared to Western Europe 49, which is basically, this is year of the major bloodshed, Holocaust, military operations, ethnic cleansing, mass starvation, those kind of things. So this is not really here, surprising, but what is surprising, this is the second lowest point. It's a 32-33. It's the famine year. And the life expectancy is even less than in 1942. Why is that paradoxical, ironic? Because 1932, 1933 was formerly peaceful years. There was no war in their time, in the time. So what I'm saying here, this reflects to some extent specific character or specificity of Ukrainian history, or for that token, East European history. Russian historians several years ago made a kind of very interesting argument or conclusion. Basically, it corresponds to this kind of statistic that even in the formerly peaceful time, Soviet citizens underwent such suffering and losses that were comparable or even incomparable to what people in Western Europe experienced even during the First or Second World War. Actually, this is a table which could lead us, open several venues for discussion. For sure, we could discuss here why the historical memory of Western and Eastern Europe that different. Because you see this kind of very, for the Eastern Europe, for the Western Europe, first of all, is the event. For Eastern Europe and Ukraine, they're not the major event because it's been outshadowed by what followed after. So this explains something. Or secondly, we could discuss what is the historical difference between historical memory, historical experience between Ukrainians and Russians. So because basically Ukraine has been occupied during the Second War and Russia was not. So the level of the loss will be different in those two cases. But I don't want to step into these lines. But also the basic discussion about historical memory. I find discussion about historical memory really interesting. But as I said before, I don't believe they're really irrelevant. I mean, trying to find out solution or just not a solution, to put new questions, so to say. I would like to turn to something different, to the conclusions that have been made by several historians, and which confirms by this table. I believe this is about modernity, modernization, and I believe in the core of this conflict between Western Union, between Eastern Union, Ukraine, and Russia is the way to modernize the country, to normalize, so to say. Return to Europe is not necessarily return to the real Europe; it's a symbol, shortcut for normalization. For moving out of this zone, and when we follow the discussions or narratives on modernization, this is mostly about urbanization, industrialization, literacy, all these kind of nice things, life expectancy that we experience on an everyday basis. What we tend to forget that basically, at the heart of modernity was a violence. And the Second World War was very much about modernization of this region. This is the conclusion has been reached by the Arno Meyer, for those who professional historians who know this name very well. He wrote A Prison Civil Regime, and he said basically that until 1914, until the beginning of the First World War, if you look on the Europe, it was basically old regime, because most of the countries were in monarchies or empires. There's aristocracy who more or less governed each of the countries. So basically, to put it shortly, this was the old regime. It took two wars to destroy the regime and to homogenize this space into space of the national relatively homogenized states. The same goes for Eastern Europe. There's not big much difference. Probably that Eastern Europe was much more, say, rural or you say backward, and much more heterogenized than Western Europe, but basically the results are more or less the same. There is, though, one difference, and I believe the difference will be significant if talking about the Ukrainian case. This is the map marked by the 1900, which represents the conflicting territorial claims of nationalism in Eastern Europe by the beginning of the 20th century. This is the, for your references, from the Norman Davies' book on history of Poland. What he shows there, that Eastern Europe, by definition, was a very conflicting zone. A zone of the fighting or different, or rivalry of different nationalism, which could be hardly read kind of integration, because disintegration was at the core. Making of each nation, in this case, as Roman Spoluk put it, was unmaking of other nation. So integration has to be disintegration of the other. It's like two stories which go in simultaneously. But what I'd like you to draw your attention, it's Eastern Europe, the whole, but Ukraine is the core. So what the specific character of Ukrainian situation, you could hardly find a single region of Ukraine which could not be claimed simultaneously, at least by the two rival nationalism. At some time, three and more. There's probably only one region which is claimed by the one nationalism, is the territory between Warsaw and Krakow, which is some kind considered to be consensual as a Polish territory. And probably Ukraine makes some kind of an opposite case when everything is contested. Every single space is contested simultaneously by several realms. So why I'm saying this? Because Ukraine has been a borderland in every sense of this world. Because you have a borderland, you have several different various races, nations, religions, whatever, social groups, which has a very different interest. And once you have a geopolitical conflict, it triggers all these conflicts and turns this region into a nightmare. And this is basically the story which was presented in the previous previous graph. Trotsky said once that the 20th century was the worst century to be born in. I could extend this quotation further, that probably Ukraine was the worst territory to be born into 20th century. Not probably Ukraine, but probably also Belarus and Poland, this territory that has been described that vividly by Tim Snyder in his book of Bloodlands. So what I'm driving to, I believe this might explain some structural ongoing problems that we have on this territories. First of all, because of this constant constellation in the 20th century, the values that dominated in this space was values of survival. And this has a long effect even after the collapse of the Soviet Union. This is the civilization map, probably for some of you it's familiar. It's from famous world value studies by Robin Engelhardt, which shows the place of the different nations on the civilization map, especially their success or failure of the modernization or normality. And the horizontal scale has survival values versus self-expression values. Where you see in Ukraine is a main kind of pole. Ukraine is on the pole, on the extreme pole, when the survival values dominate. But this is a sad story. In a sense, it tells us that history limits very much the real scenarios that could be reached on this territory. But this is a sad story, but still history doesn't work as a prison. There is space for a kind of the choice to make. And I remember very vividly when I first time heard about possible political turmoil in Ukraine after independence. This was the second day after 11 September. We have a conference when my colleague from Kyiv was presenting his paper on monitoring of Ukraine society. He came to a very important conclusion. He says basically there is some new phenomenon going on in Ukraine which is largely unnoticed. That since the late 90s, Ukrainians for the first time in their decade, which was a turmoil decade of the collapse of the Union, started to save the money. Which means this is an indicator of emergence of the new middle class. And there is evidently in the surveys that they started to plan in long terms, not in short terms of survival, but rather in the long terms. And once this is conclusion, once he has this kind of the change, you may expect seriously political problems with this country, which could lead to some kind of strong political instability, and probably even to revolution. This is 2001, 3 years before the Orange Revolution, I was very skeptical about this decision. But then, 2004, we have something very different, and to a large extent, I would say Orange Revolution was a revolution of middle class. And this is a statistic which shows the percentage of the middle class throughout the Europe or the world, and have a data on Ukraine, which lets us say that, 2005, Ukraine was a very significant chunk of the population which claimed themselves, or at least believed to be themselves, that they are member of the middle class. And secondly, second effect, and this is a fact of the last 10 years, which has been overlooked, we have emergence of new generation. Those kids who are born after the collapse of the Soviet Union, they don't even remember, no, they don't really remember the war, they don't even remember Soviet Union. They are, say, they're young, they came to adult at the time of relative stability, end of 90s, beginning of the 20s, which was also some kind of the, I would say, well-being, relative well-being. They are very well educated. Probably you know that Ukraine is one of the top countries which have a larger numbers of the young people who are attending the universities. This is not necessarily because the universities are good, but because universities serve as a babysitter. They protect the kids from the employment. And this is very much digitalized, all these kinds of the stories is. So what I'm driving it if you look on these values surveys, you could really see that Ukraine now experiences something like a generational gap, which means that most of the younger generation, young Ukrainians in the age between 15 and 25, in their values, they are much more closer to their, say, peers in the age group in Poland or in Czech than to older generation of my Ukrainians of my age. And what I'm driving at here, this has been rather neglected, but there were some very important developments in the last 10 or 20 years for, say, specific reasons or as a confluence of several factors, which means we have a relative rise of the middle class and relative emergence of the new generation, which provided some kind of accumulative effect when there is a shift of values, when Ukraine started slowly but surely moved from the survival zone to the zone of self-expression. This kind of horizontal move, and you could see it on the comparative of those two maps of this kind of world war use, which between on the beginning of the first decade of the 21st century and the end of the second century. And you will see this is really the case. There is a shift in terms of Ukraine. I don't see if you can see it clearly, but you could probably just trust me here that while in Russia the situation more or less the same, Russia is still very much close to this survival issue, you have a very significant shift or visible shift in Ukrainian case. And this led us to conclusion by several colleagues of mine, and mine included, that what could be like some kind of natural state coming Putin to power, because largely Putin corresponds to what Russian expects from their leadership. Yanukovych was kind of a small anomaly. So he didn't have the chances to stay in power unless he will change his politics and his attitudes. So basically already in 11, 12, 20, we started to make some kind of predictions that Ukraine is facing serious political crisis and revolution is not, say, is not excluded. So by issue of putting right question, what we heard today and yesterday, there was many of talk about crisis Ukraine identity, that Ukraine was created by Stalin, by Khrushchev, all these kind of things. It takes historian to tell you they were slightly otherwise. And this already what Tim just referred. When Putin was talking about creation of Ukraine, he's not referring to Stalin, to Khrushchev, he's referring to 1920s, to the after the First World War settlement. And basically, you want to know, it was not Stalin or Khrushchev who created so-called Ukraine, it was Lenin. If you're wondering if you want to know why Lenin was creating Ukrainian, you have to read his discussion with Rosa Luxemburg. When Rosa Luxemburg blamed Lenin that he's playing with Ukrainian nationalism, and Lenin responding, how could he ignore territory with that large percentage of Ukrainians, territory of a population support nationalistic parties? And he was referring specifically to the result of elections in fall 1917, the provisional government, when Ukrainian gubernias of the former Russia give a larger amount of support not to Russian but Ukrainian parties. So in a sense, this is kind of paradoxical. Emergence of Ukraine, if nation would have a passport, in the Ukrainian passport date of birth will be 1914, without a doubt. This is a young nation, without a doubt. But basically, it was a result of this process has been triggered by the First World War. And because of the borderland status of Ukraine, because of this fragmented identities, fragmented movements, nobody could really control this territory. Neither Bolsheviks, nor White Army, nor German Army, nor French Army, there are many of them. The only way to control this territory was to strike some kind of compromise. And the only viable compromise at the final end was the compromise between Russian Bolsheviks and Ukraine and the nationalism on the borderlands. This is the old thesis that's been read by the Richard Pipes a long time ago in his book on the formation of the Soviet Union, but we tend to forget it. So the basic result is that at the very core, Ukraine identity is very ambivalent because it has a both nationalistic component and both Soviet component. And because of this ambivalency, we tend to overlook the other component. And the way we look at the Ukraine, this is probably the classic example, Huntington cleft country. Because this is what beliefs say. Because we presume this is the way it works, and also we presume that identity is at the core of Ukrainian political process. I would say no. This is large exaggeration. From the beginning of the 90s, there are ongoing surveys going on, which has one and the same question. If the referendum of the 1st December 1991, the referendum which gave support to Ukraine independence, would be repeated, how would you vote? There is no single year, no single month, that there will be no majority who would still support Ukraine independence. Ironically, during the Euromaidan, you have skyrocketing the results, so to say. Yes, Ukraine is a Ukrainian identity has a crisis identity, no doubt. But those crises are not lethal. You could live with this crisis. I don't believe that Ukraine has that much different problems than Spain has, or Italy, or any other, or Belgium, or Canada, say. Yeah, those are problems. There's viable problems, and Ukraine is a relatively stable country, but different to the Russian case. It's a stable by default. But this kind of world started based on regionalism, but nobody could win, so therefore they tend to compromise. So my idea is we are asking probably wrong kind of questions. It's about not identities. It's most probably about values, because values serves as a kind of the gasoline or motor for these changes. And I will just give you one other map at the very end. This is the map of the communities on Facebook and the Russian equivalent of Facebook is called ВКонтакте. And this is the map that maps, so sorry for this clumsy wording, maps the support from Maidan and anti-Maidan. The red, reddish, and darkish people, those for Maidan, and those who are anti-Maidan, they're green. You could see this is a very different setting that one would be that we suggest. Ukraine has a really kind of the, and I believe this is presents the most mobile chunk of population, middle class and the youngsters, who are basically sort of digitalized. In this sense, you will see the most problematic region of Ukraine is Crimea and Donbas. And this is exactly when they have this kind of problem. So my conclusion is, if I may make this kind of conclusion, Russian aggression toward Ukraine presents several dangers. There is direct danger to lose sovereignty and probably even independence. But there is another danger. In a sense, Russian aggression toward Ukraine make Ukrainians return to the self, to the survival values. Why the last 10 years, and specifically Maidan, has presented a different shift. And once we have returned to identity issues, survival issues, identity issues, start discussing about historical memory, Bandera, this kind of stuff, we are lost. In the sense, Russia, Putin, is stealing future for Ukraine, for repining of the sound economic reform. So my suggestion is, I know sometimes, or quite often, some kind of suicidal tendencies are very widespread among intellectuals, so why not among historians? I don't believe we did have much rely on history when I'm talking about these issues, especially talking about historical memories and historical identities. I know that are interesting, but that are not quite relevant. And here is my final point. What I'm trying to present, the situation in Ukraine is neither that bad or not that good. There is space in between. And the space is still there. And since there is still space, we still could play with this, so to say. And I believe it opens some space for a probably limited but still very sound pragmatism. Thank you so much.